Meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren, sehr geehrter Rabbi Dr. Natan Slifkin, sehr geehrte Frau Professor Fatima Jackson, mein Name ist Sofia Helena Nowak, ich bin wissenschaftliche Mitarbeiterin der Akademieprogramme der Michael-Blumenthal-Akademie des Jüdischen Museums Berlin und begrüße Sie herzlich zu unserer heutigen Veranstaltung zum Thema Gott, Darwin und die Evolution. Es ist bereits der zweite Vortragsabend im Rahmen der Ringvorlesung Wissen und Glauben in Judentum und Islam. Die Ringvorlesung ist ein fester Bestandteil unseres jüdisch-islamischen Forums. Mit diesem Forum will die Akademie des Jüdischen Museums Berlin das Verhältnis von Judentum und Islam beleuchten und eine Plattform für die Auseinandersetzung mit religionsphilosophischen und religionspraktischen Fragen schaffen. Die Ringvorlesung ist eine von vielen Veranstaltungen, mit denen wir den Austausch zwischen Juden und Muslimen fördern wollen. Es ist uns eine große Freude, für den heutigen Abend zwei ausgewiesene Experten begrüßen zu dürfen. Rabbi Dr. Natan Slifkin ist Gründer und Direktor des Biblischen Museums für die Naturgeschichte in Beth Shemesh. Frau Professor Rana Dayani, die ursprünglich eingeladen wurde, musste leider kurzfristig absagen. Wir freuen uns sehr, dass wir mit Frau Professor Fatima Jackson von der Howard University einen exzellenten Ersatz finden konnten. Beide Referenten werden Ihnen von der Moderatorin des heutigen Abends, Dr. Kathrin Klausing, vorgestellt. Frau Klausing hat bereits die erste Veranstaltung unserer Reihe im November moderiert. Für die, die an dem Abend nicht anwesend waren, eine kurze Vorstellung von Frau Klausing. Sie ist wissenschaftliche Mitarbeiterin an dem Institut für Islamische Theologie der Universität Osnabrück. Zu ihren Schwerpunkten gehören Koranexegese und die muslimischen Perspektiven auf Feminismus und Gleichgeschlechtergerechtigkeit. Ich möchte Sie noch auf die anonymisierte Besucherbefragung hinweisen, die auf Ihren Stühlen ausgelegt ist. Wir würden uns sehr freuen, wenn Sie uns darin kurz Auskunft geben könnten, woher Sie von unserer heutigen Veranstaltung erfahren haben. Vielen Dank. Bevor ich Kathrin Klausing das Wort übergebe, möchte ich Sie noch darauf hinweisen, dass Sie die heutige Veranstaltung auf Englisch stattfindet und Sie sich an der Seite Kopfhörer nehmen können, dort, falls Sie eine Übersetzung wünschen. Nun wünsche ich uns allen einen anregenden Abend. Vielen Dank.
Thank you once again for being invited to be part of this very, very interesting project under the headline of science and faith. And I was very much looking forward for this special evening because the topic or the topic of evolution and faith is a very highly discussed topic, especially as I see it on amongst religious people or religious communities. And our first guest tonight will be speaking. Who will be speaking is Rabbi Dr. Natan Slifkin, and I will quickly welcome him here to give his talk. He is the founder and director of the Biblical Museum of Natural History in Beit Shemesh in Israel. He received his rabbinic ordination from Ors Samayach institutions, and he received also a PhD in Jewish history at Bar-Ilan University in Israel with a dissertation on rabbinic encounters with zoology. You introduced yourself just shortly before this as a zoological rabbi, which is in itself very interesting, and I hope we will hear more about that identity. And we will hear a talk today by Rabbi Dr. Slifkin on creation, dinosaurs, and evolution. And look very much forward to that.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here tonight. This is my first day ever in Germany, and I'm very honored to be invited here. Is the universe a few thousand years old, or is it millions of years old? Did dinosaurs roam the earth long before people? Did animals evolve from other animals, or were they all independently created from the world? So tonight I'd like to present the Jewish approach to these questions. I can't say that it's the Jewish approach. There is no single Jewish approach to anything. You know, Judaism is a very rich religion going back thousands of years with many different schools of thought. So the approach that I'm going to be presenting is the rationalist approach, which is the approach of Maimonides and other great figures in Judaism, which seek to accept the validity of modern science and to incorporate that together with Jewish theology. So first of all, regarding the age of the universe, So we have a lot of clear evidence that the universe is a lot more than a few thousand years old. Back home, I actually have the tooth of a dinosaur, and this tooth is 100 million years and 3 weeks old. I know that because it was 100 million years old when I bought it, and that was 3 weeks ago. But we know when people talk about evidence for the universe being very old, and then there are some people who reject that, get into arguments about carbon dating and things like that, those arguments are not relevant because for the purposes of the theological question, the question is not exactly how many billions of years old is the universe, but is the universe a few thousand years old, like a literal reading of the Bible would indicate, or is it a lot more than that? And there's very clear evidence that it's a lot more than that without getting onto carbon dating. And the simplest evidence is that in the layers of rock where you find dinosaur bones, that's all you find. In those layers of rock, you don't find the bones of people or cats or dogs or lions or tigers, right? So the fact that there's very clear differences between the types of fossils found in different rocks shows that the world is a lot more than a few thousand years old. Now, for many people, that presents a challenge because the Bible implies that the universe was created in 6 days just a few thousand years ago. But in Judaism, there is a very long history of interpreting the Bible non-literally, in many cases. For example, the Bible refers to, the hand of God, right? Whereas Judaism maintains God does not have a hand. Rather, it is a metaphor. It is a figure of speech. Right, the Bible speaks about an eye for an eye, which has always been interpreted in Judaism non-literally as referring to monetary payment. And certainly when it comes to the account of creation, which is one of the most mysterious, esoteric parts of the Bible, there is a long-standing Jewish tradition to interpret it non-literally. And in fact, the great rabbinic scholar Maimonides writes that contrary to popular belief, the account of creation given in the Bible is not intended to be literal in all its parts. And you see two very important things there. Number one, that the account of creation is not to be interpreted literally. And number two, that it's contrary to popular belief. In other words, even in Maimonides' time, he was also struggling with people who were insisting on interpreting it literally. Right? But Maimonides nevertheless insisted that it's not to be interpreted literally. And therefore, the 6 days of creation need not be days as we understand them, right? And in fact, there's a verse in the Bible, for 1,000 years are in God's eyes like a fleeting day, all right? So God's days might not be like our days. In fact, there's the story of the man who goes to God and he says, God, is it true that 1,000,000 years is in your eyes like a second? And God says, yes, it's true. In my eyes, 1,000,000 years is a second. And the man says, God, is it true that in your eyes, $1,000,000 is just like 1 cent? And God says, yes, it's true. And the man says, God, can I have a cent? And God says, sure, just a second. So we don't need to interpret the biblical account of creation literally. But what happens with evolution, however, evolution raises some much more interesting questions. In other words, yes, you have the question of the conflict between evolution and the literal reading of the text, meaning that in the Bible, it looks like you have animals being created separately, whereas evolution maintains that animals developed one from the other. But we've already said that the biblical text of Genesis does not need to be interpreted literally. But the evolution raises some interesting conceptual challenges and conflicts with religion also. So before getting into that, there's firstly something we have to clarify. Is evolution a fact or a theory? Who thinks fact? Who thinks theory? Who thinks both? So the answer is evolution is a very vague word, an ambiguous word. Evolution has two aspects to it. There's one aspect of evolution, which is common ancestry, the idea that all living things are related in one big family tree, that originally there was one simple life form, and that developed into fishes, into amphibians, into reptiles, into birds and mammals, without getting into how that happened, but just the idea that everything did develop and everything is related in one big family tree. And that's common ancestry, right? The idea that there's a common ancestor to all living things. And then you get onto the mechanism of evolution. The mechanism of evolution is the explanation of how did things change into the other? How did a fish change into an amphibian? How did an amphibian change into a reptile? How did a reptile change into a bird or mammal? So that's evolutionary mechanisms. Now the first part, common ancestry, that's what's described in scientific terms as the fact of evolution. Because it's accepted as a historical fact. And there's all kinds of evidence. There's convergence from many different fields of science. This morning, I was at the Museum of Natural History here in Berlin. They have a wonderful exhibit on evolution. And you can go to the museum, you can learn about all the convergent evidence. But just very simply, I think a whale is the best evidence for evolution. You look at a whale superficially on the outside, a whale looks like a big fish, a shark. But anatomically, a whale is completely different. Inside a whale's flipper, there is a five-fingered hand, just like ours. Right? The skeleton of a whale is much more similar to a land animal than to any fish. And even more basically, whales have to come to the surface to breathe. Why? Why can't they breathe underwater like fish? So everything about the anatomy of a whale only makes sense if we interpret whales as having evolved from land animals. And you also find, in terms of the fossil record, so people talk about, but aren't there gaps in the record? Yes, there are gaps, but what about the fossils that are there? You do find intermediates between land animals and whales. So sure, there are some gaps, because the fossil record is not perfect. But the fossils that are there, fit with the evolutionary picture, not with the idea that animals were all created in their final form. So there's a wealth of evidence in the natural world converging to show the fact of evolution that animals are all descended from a common ancestor. But then you get on to the mechanism of evolution, what's called the theory of evolution. Now, it's important to understand, actually, I don't know how this works in German, but in English, the word theory has two different meanings. In English, the word theory means something that's just made up. But theory also has a scientific meaning, right? Like gravitational theory. Right? No one's going to walk off a building and say, oh, gravity is just a theory. Now, a theory in scientific terms means a mechanism that's well corroborated by different forms of evidence. Now, is it well corroborated, right? Is the evidence for the mechanism of evolution, right, the idea of random mutations combined with natural selection, is that a well-founded theory? So my answer to that is, I don't have an answer. Meaning, I'm going to show you why, I'm going to explain why the answer is irrelevant. Right, I'm not a scientist, I'm a rabbi, so it's not my position to comment on whether certain scientific things are true or false. Certainly within the scientific community, the consensus is that the explanation for evolutionary mechanisms is well-founded. And as a rabbi, what I want to say is that, sure, great, that's fine. And let me explain what I mean. Why do so many people, religious people, Jewish, Christian, Muslim, why are there so many people who object to evolution? What they're objecting to is the idea that these scientists claim that they have a scientific explanation for how life developed, but we know that God did it. Right? They object to the idea of having a scientific explanation because they see that as painting God out of the picture. But it's very strange. Because in no other field of science do we say that. Right? We pray to God when people are sick, and we speak about God healing the sick, but we still have a science of medicine. Right? We speak about God's hand in history, but we still have historians. Right? We have historians who document everything that happens in history. So religion has never had any problem talking about God's role in history, God's role in medicine, God's role in weather, God's role in everything in the world. Even though there's always been, that's never conflicted with the idea of having a scientific explanation. And the accepted understanding has always been that God works through science. In fact, science itself is the most incredible phenomenon. The fact that we have laws of nature that govern all phenomena in the universe, right? It's a remarkable universe that we live in. And the laws of the universe are not just any old laws. They allow for the formation of energy turning into matter and planetary systems forming and life. So the laws of nature are an extraordinary creation, and God works through them. So in the same way as God can work through history and meteorology and medicine, God can work through evolutionary biology. In the same way as in the lifespan of the individual, right? You can have an egg turning into a tadpole, turning into a frog, and no one's claiming that that has to be, you know, with supernatural, you know, breaking the laws of nature. Well, it's through nature. So the same is true on a species level. So this is the important part to understand why there is no conflict between the idea of an evolutionary mechanism, whatever it is, and religion. In fact, just a few years after Darwin put forth the origin of the species, so there was a very important rabbi in Germany, Rabbi Samson Raphael Hirsch, and he himself was not yet convinced of evolution. It was a new discovery, and he hadn't yet been convinced by it. But what he said was that if evolution is ever proven true, it will be testimony to the creative wisdom of God. A very important phrase, creative wisdom. That instead of having to separately create all these different things, God just created these laws of nature that enable many different life forms to develop. To give an analogy, imagine you have two robotics engineers. One of them creates, and they need to create robots for the military, for the army. One of them creates a robot that can travel in the desert through sand, that can go through the jungle, that can dive into the water, that can fly. He designs all these different robots, all of which are perfectly suited to their task. The other engineer, instead of designing all these different robots, he designs a computer program that if you tell this computer program what the environment is going to, what the situation is going to be, this computer program will be able to devise a robot that will fit that situation. Which engineer is greater, the first engineer or the second engineer? The second engineer, that takes much more skill. So that's the creative wisdom that Rabbi Hirsch is speaking about. Right? The idea of that creating the incredible richness of animal life that we see through laws of nature is a much more elegant system than having to create everything separately. Now, with regard to the particular system of random mutation and natural selection, so some people object to that because it's random. And they say the universe is directed, it's purposeful, it's not random. But again, when you start to think about it, you realize that this objection does not have basis, because Judaism, religion in general, right, has always acknowledged that there are things in the world which appear to be random. Certainly lotteries exist, right? And lotteries appear to be random. Right? And in fact, in the Bible, the land of Israel was divided by a lottery. So certainly, Judaism, the Bible has always acknowledged that there are things in the universe which appear to be random, but we don't see that as ruling out God's involvement. So, whatever the explanation of the evolutionary mechanism is, even if it is one that involves randomness, it does not present any theological problem whatsoever. Now, there are many people who can accept the evolution of animal life, but when it comes to the evolution of people, they draw the line. In fact, my own mother, who's 82, bless her, when she found out that I'd written the book Reconciling Evolution with Religion, she was very upset with me. She was very upset, and finally she said to me, "Natan, if you want to believe that you evolved from monkeys, fine. Just don't tell me that I did." So, why would somebody want to believe that we evolved from monkeys, or to put it more scientifically precisely, that us and monkeys share a common ancestor? Right? It's because it would explain a lot of aspects of the human body, right? Lower back pain. Anyone suffer from lower back pain? Right? It would be understandable if we evolved from creatures who were originally, you know, on all fours. Right? The appendix. I nearly died from appendicitis once. The appendix has some benefits, but the disadvantages of the appendix are much greater than the advantages. So why do we have an appendix? It makes sense if it's left over from when we were animals and when the appendix was a useful organ. Right? Or when we get scared, we get goosebumps. I don't know how you say that in German. Right, goosebumps that the hairs on your skin stand up when you're cold or when you're scared. What's the point of that? Doesn't serve any purpose, but if it's left over from when we used to be furry, and then fur, when you're cold, it stands on end to keep you warmer. Or when you're scared, when there's a predator coming, it stands on end to make you seem bigger. Right, so it would make sense. So there's a lot of aspects of human anatomy which make sense in the light of evolution. But many people object to that because how does that fit with the Bible saying, you know, that the man's special, the man is created in the image of God? So there too, when you think about it, what does it mean, you know, the image of God? The biblical idea of man being special has nothing to do with our physical bodies. Okay, so we walk on two legs. Well, you know, so do penguins. Right? There's nothing special or important about our physical bodies. The important thing is our soul, and what I mean by that is our moral responsibilities. It doesn't matter what we come from, it matters what we have now become. The point is that, think about it on an individual level. On an individual level, what do we start off at? A drop of sperm and an egg, right? Nothing a divine image about that, right? But the point is, what do we become? We become something with a mind that is capable of making moral choices between good and evil. An animal never does that, right? Jane Goodall was living with the chimpanzees in Tanzania, studying them for many years, right? And she saw sometimes chimpanzees would kill and eat other chimpanzees. Now, no one's gonna say that the chimpanzees should be prosecuted, you know, for murder, for cannibalism. It's a chimpanzee. Chimpanzees are allowed to do whatever comes naturally to them. But as human beings, we have a unique responsibility to rise up and to overcome that which might come naturally to us, and to restrain ourselves and develop ourselves intellectually and morally. And it's funny, you know, people see this as the big challenge between science and religion. And there are very serious challenges that science presents for religion, but this is not one of them. You know, hundreds of years ago, way before Darwin, the rabbinic commentaries were discussing why is it that man is created on the sixth day and the same day as animals? Can't we get our own day? Aren't we so special? Why can't we have our own day? And what they explain is that man was created as an animal, and only then he was given the potential to become more than just an animal. And if we just follow our natural instincts, just do whatever we want to do, right, then we are living life no differently than an animal. But if we choose to develop our minds, our souls, our spirit, right, to choose good over evil, to choose the selfless choice over the selfish choice, then we can become much more than just an animal. So there is no scientific problem that we have with evolution. It's just a matter of the philosophical perspective on it. That whereas a secular evolutionist will see man as nothing more than just a highly intelligent animal, but from a religious perspective, man might physically have descended from animals, but intellectually, spiritually, he has the ability to become much more than just an animal. Thank you.
Thank you, Rabbi Slifkin. That was on the second. perfect 20 minutes. I will welcome now to the desk here Professor Dr. Fatimah Jackson, who was so welcoming to answer the request to join us here, very spontaneously, as I heard. I'm very happy to meet you personally here. Fatimah Jackson, Professor Dr. Fatimah Jackson, is currently the director of the W. Montague Cobb Research Lab, and she has been teaching applied biological anthropology for decades, I think, is appropriate to say that. And she received several prizes and awards. I will just name two of that. For example, she received in 2012 the first Ernest E. Just Prize in Medical and Public Health Research. Her research focuses on models that facilitate our understanding of human diversity and microevolution. And before I Dr. Fatima Jackson, you also engage, and that's how I got to know you, with Muslim scholars at some panels in order to discuss this very interesting mixture of the discussion around evolution and Islam or Islamic faith. So we will hear your talk on reconciling human evolution with Islam, and I will welcome you now.
Thank you very much, and I am very honored to be here and very grateful for the long trip. I don't know what happened to last night. I feel like I was been stuck on a plane, but coming here, it's all worth it. And I wish that our Islamic scholars were as knowledgeable as our rabbi here, because that would make my job so much easier. So I appreciate your delving into the zoology and the scientific mindset on evolution. I'm going to talk a bit about reconciling human evolution with Islam. I'm not an Islamic scholar. I'm just a practicing Muslim woman. I'm, of course, concerned about seeming incongruities between Islam and what I study, which is evolution. But I have decided that, in fact, there are no major gaps. And it really falls into the category of what do we take allegorically and what do we take literally? And that most of our problems in our belief systems are misapplication of allegorical phrases as if they are literal. Okay. So let's see if we can make this go one way or the other. Okay, so I want to give an overview of evolution. I'd like to talk about the significance of evolution in 21st century science and explain what we mean as scientists when we use terms like random, you know, and distinguish between microevolution and macroevolution, and then return to the subject of what does Islam have to say about evolution, and what is evolution, okay? So the definition of evolution is simply that we're talking about change. Change in the inherited characteristics of a biological population. That's all. There's no anti-deity notion in evolution. That's something that has been applied by people who are themselves atheists. But I find no contradiction in being a strong believer in the one deity and being an evolutionary scientist. In fact, as the rabbi has indicated, we see the action of the creator through evolution and through the mechanisms of evolution. Evolutionary processes give rise to diversity at every level of biological organization, from species to individual organisms, down to molecules such as DNA and proteins. You can see, and I'm telling you as a scientist, you can see the impact of a creator. It just means that it's possible to believe and to be a good scientist, and to not allow misinterpretation of the religious texts to cloud our scientific vision. Why is evolution important? Well, the reason for evolution, it's about adaptation, about adjusting to new and changing environmental conditions. If we don't adjust, we die. If we don't adjust, we become extinct. So evolution is absolutely essential for improved survival and reproduction. And Dobzhansky, who's a very famous population geneticist, said that nothing in biology makes sense outside of the context of evolution. So evolution is the theoretical premise upon which all of biology is based. And without biology, it's impossible to understand medicine or related fields. So evolution is very much a part of our mindset. As a Muslim, why is evolution important? Well, we have a number of references to the Creator as one who changes things. Everything else changes, the Creator doesn't change. So he is Al-Khalaq, the one who brings into existence everything from non-existence. He's the Creator or the Maker. He is Al-Bari, which literally means the evolver. So, you know, it reminds me that in the when Darwin's book first came out, one of the objections of the Catholics was that this was a Mohammedan notion of evolution, so which means that anything we don't like, we ascribe to people we don't care for. But God or Allah is referred to as the evolver or the maker of order, and he is al-musirir, the one who forms his creatures in different pictures. He's the fashioner, the organizer. So where's the problem? We're focusing as evolutionary scientists on the mechanisms, the way that things change. That's our duty as responsible natural historians. But the Creator, who makes it all possible, that's within the realm of our belief systems. And there is no contradiction there. A lot of times we get hung up on the concept of species. And I take this example from the domesticated dog. The domesticated dog evolved from the gray wolf, Canis lupus, and in the course of tiny, tiny, small changes, what we see is that we get variations in the dog. And some of these variations are really profound. But when you analyze the dog at the molecular level, all dogs belong to the same species. If they're big, huge, Great Danes, or if they're tiny Chihuahuas, they're the same species. So we make a big deal about the concept of species, but it's kind of like this diagram. If you look at this diagram from left to right, at what point does it stop being blue and start being red? It's continuity, you see? That's the same kind of continuity with evolution. You can't point to one generation where a mother gives birth to a child of a different species. It's gradual change. It's just that our human lives are so short that we don't see the magnitude of change. That's within the purview of our Creator. But we know that that gradual change over time, which is exactly what Darwin talked about, we know that it's a reality because we have the fossil record. We look at the fossil record, we can see the gradual change. We look at the molecular record in the DNA, and we also see evidence of change. So we have multiple lines of evidence suggesting that species are transitional, that we too are changing. In fact, one of the things that is being heavily discussed in the scientific community is how we are going to have to change our bodies if we're going to live on Mars. Now, personally, I'm not going to live on Mars. Too old. But for those young people who will be going to Mars, they can't live on the Martian environment with our bodies. So some of the things we'll have to do because of the high radiation levels is change our melanin content. It gets very interesting, you know? I also think that the Creator has a sense of humor in dealing with us. Species are malleable. That is, they change via the process of evolution. So here we have a zebroid, it's called. It's a cross between a zebra and a horse. Again, something quite new. You don't usually encounter this, but it shows also how connected species are. So what is scientifically known about human evolution? Well, we know that all human biology and behavior is subject to the same kinds of changes that we see in other life forms. We are a part of nature. We're not separate from nature. I like that question about why didn't we have our own day for creation? We're not that important. You know, we are the keystone species, as the ecologists say, that is that we control the lives of many other species. But if we cease to exist, if Homo sapiens cease to exist on this planet, life would go on. Now that's the reality. We don't want that to happen. We want to forestall our evolution as much as possible. But I do believe that it's not our bodies that make us unique. It is perhaps our soul, but as a scientist, we don't study the soul. But we can look at cognitive processes. And the cognitive processes have changed. Most of human evolution has been from the neck up, not from the neck down. It's been from the neck up. In fact, this is a long list of our progenitors, from Sahelanthropus chadensis that lived 7 million years ago down to Homo sapiens, us. And we are more closely connected to these fossil ancestors than we are to any living non-human primate. So when people say, I don't believe in evolution because I didn't come from a monkey, it's like, well, I didn't either. No one came from a monkey. You know? And in fact, you'd have to go back way beyond the 7 million year timeline to even find a non-human primate who would have shared an ancestor with us. So again, evolution is often misunderstood. Now this is a current view of the temporal and geographical distributions of modern and pre-modern human populations. So if we start just at 2 million years ago, we start with Homo ergaster, which is a form of homonym that was originally evolved in East Africa, and then from East Africa spread into Arabia and then out. And it became the precursor of Homo erectus, which lived for a very long time in Java, in Indonesia, and in China. In fact, when Homo erectus was in China, Homo sapiens was evolving in Africa. And we have all these other names, for example, Homo antecessor and Homo rhodesiensis. Finally, Homo neanderthalensis, which you probably have heard something about, Homo neanderthalensis, because the first Neanderthal was found here in Germany. But it was not a German. It was a separate species. In fact, when we found subfossil material from Homo neanderthalensis, the first question was, are these Homo neanderthalensis more genetically close to modern-day Germans? Or are they close, are they not? And the answer is not. That we all, as Homo sapiens, are derived from an ancestral African population. And so when I tell people that vision of who we are as a people, we're one people. And we have, yes, diversity among us, but all non-African molecular diversity is a subset of African diversity. Africa is our home. It's our ancestral home, and it's our molecular home. What are the mechanisms that change over time? Well, of course, we have mutation, but we also have gene flow, where genes come into the population from another population, and then they change the resulting offspring population. Genetic drift, where one person disproportionately contributes to the genetics of the subsequent generation. Recombination, where the genetic information is shuffled, in like you're shuffling a deck of cards on the chromosome. Assortive mating, where we are selectively choosing our mates. Maybe we only want a blonde mate, or we only want a tall mate. And over time, that if that's done by a large number of people, it will change the gene frequencies in the population. Population will become more blonde and taller, okay? And of course, natural selection. So these are the major processes by which populations change. And when they change, that's what we mean is they evolve. So this is what some of our pre-modern humans may have looked like. And these are artist renditions from the skeletal material. And I'm sure if you look very closely at some of these people, they look like relatives, people you might know. But we have a wide range. And another interesting thing is that the phenotypic features, the body features, don't all correlate in the way that we are familiar with them. For example, we are familiar with blonde hair and blue eyes going together. But we have, even now in Central Australia, Aboriginal people who are dark brown complexion with blonde hair. This is why I believe that our Creator has a sense of humor. He mixes us all up. And we are also finding that in Europeans and East Asians, Eurasians, that about 5% of their genomes are derived from either Neanderthals or Denisovans. In fact, the Denisovans are another archaic species that interacted, that interbred with Neanderthals and interbred with early humans who ended up in Southeast Asia. So the picture is getting more complicated in human evolution. It looks as though we are collectively a hybrid species, that we have material from Neanderthals, we have material from Denisovans, and probably from a yet-to-be-found archaic African ancestor that admixed with the early Homo sapiens. So that tells me that fundamentally we are lovers. That is, we encounter another species, and the option is could be to kill them or to love them. We often chose to love them. I don't know if we're getting smarter or dumber in the course of human evolution. I'm not sure. I wish we would have more loving. So Prophet Adam always comes up in my discussions with Muslim scholars who say to me, but you can't explain Prophet Adam, you know? And I brought in some quotations from the Quran. The Quran says in Surah 38, verse 75, about Prophet Adam, whom I created by my two hands. So this statement does not categorically negate the possibility of the emergence of humans by some evolutionary process, because as is consistent with the interpretation we just heard, our timeline is not the Creator's timeline. I always say to my colleagues, stop trying to put the Creator in your pocket. He doesn't belong in our pockets. We belong in his pocket. The Quran says in the second chapter, verse 30, the Lord said to the angels, I will create a Khalifa on earth. They said, how do you install someone who makes mischief and sheds blood, which we certainly do too much of that, right? The angels had that right. They said, while we praise your mercy and glorify your name. And he, Allah, said, I know what you don't know. So that's important, that when we say something is random in science, what we mean is that we don't know, but we're sure there's an answer out there. It's the logical positivism that is characteristic of Western science. So when we say, as scientists, random mutation, that means we're not sure what caused that mutation, but we're going to keep studying it because we're sure that we can determine. And in fact, what we're finding is that certain agents will produce a characteristic lesion. So you always know that carbon tetrachloride produces a particular lesion on the chromosome. The mutation is well known. So now, instead of saying that mutations are totally unknown, we're beginning to understand the kinds of disorders that can, as specific disorders, mutational disorders that can be produced by particular compounds or physical stresses and so forth. This statement may mean that the angels were referring to already existing beings on earth that we're spreading corruption, perhaps through inadequate, and I would say, neurological development. Because remember I told you that the bulk of human evolution has been from the neck up, has been involving our crania, involving the shape of our brain, and most important, the frontal area, the executive component of the brain. This is just showing some of the migrations of early modern humans out of Africa, and we are just beginning to understand the bulk of the migrations within Africa. That's something that my lab has been focused on. The picture of human migration suggests commonality, that we are all very much related to each other. And it doesn't matter if you're born here in Germany, you're also a tropical animal. You're a tropical animal who speaks German. I'm a tropical animal who speaks English, you know? And if you take off all of the paraphernalia that we have ascribed to us, underneath you find a single species. Each of us are so identical to each other that it's amazing. Fortunately, we have cultural differences, because variation is the raw material of evolution. If you don't have variation, you're dead, because there's nothing to work with. So we have added variation through our culture and sociolinguistic diversity. This is just showing migratory routes by Adam. This is migratory routes by Hawa or Eve. And the genetic footprints go first out of Africa through two routes, a southern route and a northern route into Arabia. And it looks like the Neanderthal admixture took place first in the Near East, in that area around Israel and Palestine, in that area, because Neanderthals were coming into certain cave sites. Humans were occupying those cave sites. We thought that maybe they were time sharing, you know, that when one group was there, another group was away. Now we're finding, no, they were there at the same time. And we're finding hybrids. And we find evidence of Neanderthal genes in modern humans. So it's pretty clear there was gene flow. This is just showing, again, the unity of humanity. And then I just wanted to make the point that we are not separate from the rest of creation, that we are in fact a part of creation as ego versus nature. And to me, it's a maturational perspective. As we mature, we begin to see ourselves as a part of the world around us rather than lording over the world, because that was an illusion. We never had the wisdom to lord over the world. Now, a couple of conceptual issues for Islamic consideration. We have discovered that there are chemical markers in association with genes that can change rates of transcription and translation, which is the way genes express themselves. So these chemical markers are influenced by the things we see, the foods we eat, the drugs we take, and they remain in our bodies. And they are passed on to our offspring for at least four generations in mammals. Why is this important? It means that people who suffered a horrendous event like the Holocaust, if they survived that experience changed the chemical composition in association with their genes. It doesn't change the sequence of the genes, it changes the gene expression patterns. And then they're able to pass that on to their offspring. In fact, some of the earliest epigenetic studies were done on people who suffered under the Nazis with the Dutch famine, and the children that were born during the famine seemed to be predisposed to a different set of diseases than their parents, and also the survivors of the Nazi Holocaust. We've just recently written a paper in a Journal of Clinical Epigenetics talking about the epigenetic effects of 400 years of enslavement and institutionalized racism in America, the effect on African Americans, because it's that same kind of adverse effect having a long-term multi-generational effect on descendant populations. So that's one of the challenges. And again, this is just showing a schematic of the epigenetic changes. Another conceptual issue is the craniometric neurological changes that I mentioned. And the neurological changes, remember I said that most of human evolution has been from the neck up. In other words, we got the bipedal part down pretty quickly. But then the neurological development is, we are still evolving. This is just showing the range of human skulls. If you look at that last line, you can see how we go from an indentation here and a fairly small crania to a much rounded, bigger crania in the modern human on the far right. Can you all see that? Okay. So, in the Quran, Allah says that he's gonna grab those lying, sinning people by their forelocks. And he says it several times. And I'm reading this and I'm saying, why is Allah saying that? Like, that sounds so crazy. Why is he grabbing people by their forelocks right here? Except as a metaphor, because in the frontal lobe, this is the executive section of the brain. This is where, when we've given people lobotomies or when they've accidentally had a lobotomy where a pole has, say, gone through their eye and damaged this part of the brain, this frontal area of the brain, they lose their morality. So I'm thinking that as this part of the brain developed and began to bulge and move from a horizontal position to more of a vertical position, that's concomitant with increasing morality, increasing consciousness of values and so forth, which is why maybe what the sinners lack is they have a lying, sinful executive center instead of forelock. The frontal lobes are considered our emotional control center and the home of our personality. So some of the passages in the Quran is not a science book, but some of the passages hint to scientific processes. They give us ideas about things we should look into. Biocultural adaptations are the most important factors in human evolution. This is what's going to save us into the 21st century. I believe that belief in a creator, God, is in fact part of our evolution. It's evidenced when we look at the behavior of the Neanderthals who buried their dead, the early modern humans who buried their dead. Why were they burying their dead? Okay, maybe they didn't like the smell. But then what? Maybe, why would they put valuable tools and trinkets in the grave? Why would they put food in the grave unless they had a concept of something beyond death? So it makes us think that as our bodies have evolved, most pronouncedly in human evolution, our cranial capacities, our cognitive capabilities have evolved. Until we are at this point, which is not the end point, but just part of that continuum. Modern human variation, the Quran says, O mankind, we created you from a single pair, a male and a female, and made you into nations and tribes that you may know each other, not that you may despise each other. Verily, the most honored of you in the sight of God is the one who is the most righteous of you. And Allah has full knowledge of and is well aware and well acquainted with all things. And maybe this is a reason behind the tremendous polytypism, we call it, the tremendous diversity that we see in modern humans. We're all the same species, but there's no one single type of human. So my husband over here doesn't represent all humans. I don't represent all humans. None of us represents all humans, and yet we are all humans. We're polytypism, many different types. The Quran and the Sunnah, because those are the two sources that we as Muslims rely on, they don't confirm or deny the theory of biological evolution or the process referred to as natural selection. The question of evolution remains purely a matter of scientific inquiry. The theory of evolution must stand or fall on its own scientific merits, and that means that the physical evidence either confirms or the theory or conflicts with it. And that's the official position of the ulama, of the Islamic scholars. But it doesn't mean that everyone has been convinced. It doesn't mean that literalist interpretations of allegorical phrases will not continue to plague us, because we take two steps forward, one step backwards. And that's the way it is for all belief systems. So with that, I think I should probably end my presentation. And I thank you all very much for your consideration. And I look forward to your questions.
Bevor ich das öffne für Sie, werde ich noch zwei Fragen stellen. Ich werde das auf Deutsch machen. So I would like to ask you, to put on your headphones. Ich werde das auf Deutsch machen, weil das letzte Mal war das so, dass dann alle auf Englisch ihre Fragen gestellt haben. Und ich habe das Gefühl gehabt, das hat so ein bisschen entmutigt, auch auf Deutsch Fragen zu stellen. Und ich will jetzt mit dem Beispiel vorgehen, dass Sie in Englisch oder Deutsch eben Ihre Fragen stellen können. Ich habe eine Frage an Rabbi Slifkin. Und zwar eigentlich habe ich zwei, über die wir vorher schon kurz gesprochen haben. Und zwar, wie ist das eigentlich gekommen, dass Sie sich überhaupt mit Evolution oder mit der Evolutionstheorie beschäftigt haben und dann auch jemand geworden ist, der dazu eine positive Haltung entwickelt hat? Das ist ja anscheinend nicht immer so gewesen.
So actually, I originally did not accept evolution. You know, I brought up in a sector of Orthodox Jewish society which rejected evolution. And I came to it in a bit of an unusual way. It was actually while studying rabbinic texts which stressed the idea, the value of seeing God working through nature. Instead, that it's more valuable to perceive God working through nature than working through a miracle. That I took that concept and then applied it to animal life and realized, well, one second, so that means it would be better to see God developing animal life through some kind of systematic way rather than just, you know, zapping everything into existence. So it's actually, I actually came to accepting evolution through my religious studies.
Thank you. Ihre modische Auswahl, die sagt ja auch ein bisschen, Ihr modisches Erscheinen sagt ja auch ein bisschen was darüber aus, wie Sie so mit Ihrer Umwelt interagieren. Ich habe, als ich mir Ihren CV angeguckt habe, Rabbi Slifkin, auch gesehen, dass es mal die ein oder andere Diskussion gegeben hat in Ihrem Lebenslauf zu Publikationen, die Sie gemacht haben. Nun haben Sie in Israel ein Museum gegründet für Naturgeschichte. Gibt es dort, also machen Sie dort auch Ausstellungen, Evolutionsausstellungen oder Ausstellungen zur Evolution selber? Und wenn nein, was ich vermute, warum nicht?
So yes, my work has created some controversy in the past. My books on this topic were banned by certain sectors of the Orthodox Jewish community. Now, the museum that I run in Israel is the Biblical Museum of Natural History. And we do not have any exhibits on evolution for two reasons. Number one is that it's a museum about biblical natural history, the animal world of the Bible. And so evolution doesn't really play a role in that because it's not discussed in the Bible. The second reason is that although, as you heard, you know, I accept evolution, but I recognize that many other people do not. And if we were to have in the museum an exhibit about evolution, then many of our Jewish, Muslim, and Christian visitors would not come. And it would be a big shame, because we have a lot of valuable material to offer them. And it would be a big shame if they wouldn't come because of certain exhibits that they would find religiously offensive. So for those two reasons, we do not have any such exhibits in our museum. But my book on this topic is available in the museum store.
Professor Dr. Jackson, one question from me. Von außen sieht das für uns in Deutschland manchmal so aus, als wären die Diskussionen um Evolution, Glauben und deren Vereinbarkeit oder Nichtvereinbarkeit in den USA viel schärfer geführt wird und auch von viel größeren oder besser organisierten Gruppierungen. Mich würde jetzt mal so interessieren, ich meine, da sind also klar solche Stichworte, die dann immer fallen, sind Kreationismus, Schulen, die bestimmte Lehrpläne nicht akzeptieren oder akzeptieren. Mich würde mal so ein Einblick interessieren, wenn Sie uns den geben können, in so ein Mikrokosmos dessen, nämlich wie so die Diskussionen in muslimischer Gelehrsamkeit, muslimischen Gemeinschaften um Evolution in den USA funktioniert. Wie sieht sowas aus? Wie können wir uns das vorstellen?
So, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So, evolution is met with some skepticism in the lay community in the United States. And I think it's because it has been misunderstood that the humans equal monkey notion of evolution is an immediate turnoff. Plus the fact that evolutionary theory to some extent has been hijacked by people like Richard Dawkins and other atheists who not only are just atheists, they're hostile to any belief system. And I think that it's incumbent upon us to show that it's possible to be a believer and to be a scientist simultaneously, and that in fact belief can augment scientific research. It can facilitate one scientific research. So we have large swaths of the American population that are really pretty ignorant about science. And in fact, we have a polar vortex that's now sweeping into the country, reducing ambient temperatures, air temperatures. And so our president said, hey, what happened to global warming? He's very sarcastic. What happened to global warming? Because he doesn't believe in climate change. Not understanding that climate change means increased fluctuation in very hot temperatures, very cold temperatures. You know, so this is at the top. You can imagine going on down, it's not getting any better. So we, as in the scientific community, are trying to educate, trying to get the word out. And for some in the Muslim community, they have been very resistant because I hate to call the people ulama, because they're not really religious scholars. They're like people who have high school degrees, and then they studied a little Islam. Maybe they went for a week or two in Medina. And they are not scholars. They are not scholars. But in the American Islamic context, they hold a lot of sway because Islam just had a resurgence in America. It came with the enslaved Africans, but then for about 60 years, the Islam did not grow. You know, that was in the beginning of the 20th century. And then when it came in again, it came in a distorted way through the eyes of other cultures and not with a strong intellectual focus. So we're just beginning to reassert an intellectual focus into American Islam. I know I'm going to be in trouble for saying this, but it's true. We have been fighting against the reactionary interpretations of Islam that stymie people. We call it prison Islam. It's the Islam you learn in prison, and it's very rigid, and it doesn't allow for flexibility and questioning. And now we're making an effort to introduce that in, and the good thing is that so many of our Muslim youth want to become physicians and scientists and so forth. So they've got to have contact with evolutionary theory, and they've got to somehow reconcile it, just as we reconcile quantum mechanics. And it says, you know, energy, quantum theory says energy can neither be created or destroyed. And we tell the students, yeah, learn that, and then say, except by Allah. So then there's not a problem, you see? So with this, learn the evolutionary theory, improve upon that theory, but don't lose your soul. Don't lose your belief. Because I feel that religious belief, belief in a creator, is part of our evolutionary mandate. And I think that that's the direction that we're going in the States. But yeah, we've had some difficulties.
Ich würde jetzt öffnen für die Allgemeinheit. Also ich schaue mich mal kurz um, ob es hier Fragen gibt. Sie können sich einfach so kenntlich machen. Really easy crowd.
Don't be shy.
Letztes Mal musste ich. Ich fange mal hier an. Dann, ich habe Sie gesehen. Ja. Kommt gleich ein Mikrofon. Hier war es. Ja, genau. Die Dame war zuerst.
Soll ich auf Deutsch sprechen oder auf Englisch? Ja. Ich möchte die Frau Fatima fragen, ob sie denkt, da gibt es irgendwie ein Ziel, wo es hingeht und ob da auch irgendwie vielleicht sowas, also wenn sie denkt, dass das also göttliche Absicht ist, ob sie da Vorstellungen hat, wie das gemeint ist sozusagen, ob das, also ob es einen Endpunkt gibt oder einen Höhepunkt.
So the only destination that we know of in science is extinction. That's where we're going. Just like all of us are going to the grave, and then all of our species is going to extinction. We just don't want it to happen today, right? We want to slow it down. So we do things and we try to evolve ourselves in ways that will slow down our demise as a species. Because 99% of human life, 99% of the life on this planet has already become extinct. So that will be our common destiny as well. But while we are here, we want to live the good life. We want to be the best creatures that we can be. Evolution doesn't have a direction. It's not making us better and better. Ideally, we're becoming better adapted. But the problem is the environment is always changing, you know? So the 30 years ago, even 300 years ago, no one sat under these lights, you know, and the fluorescent lights that flicker, that change our biorhythms. So we're constantly being exposed to new environmental challenges. And I guess what we would want to do to forestall extinction is to maintain the diversity that's within our species. And that's very important. And that, of course, is one of the philosophical challenges of the high rate of HIV/AIDS in Africa, because look, 83% of human variation is in Africa, in continental Africa. Why? Because that's where our species evolved. Wherever a species has evolved, that's where you find the greatest diversity. So you want to maintain that diversity because we can't make genes. We can only take genes from one species and put it in another species. We can fiddle with existing genes, but we cannot make brand new genes. We don't have that technology yet. So it behooves us, plus it's ethical, for us to maintain the variation, the diversity that exists among us. And that means being more open-minded and sharing the wealth. I could be a preacher, huh?
Yeah, I noticed that.
You know my name is Jackson, so I could be a singer, right?
Dr. Slifkin, maybe you want to add something?
Well, I try not to predict the future, except in hindsight. But with regard to evolution having a goal, a direction, what I would say is that if the result of the hundreds of millions of years of evolution are the human brain, which is the most complex entity in the universe, which is, you know, qualitatively different from anything else in the animal kingdom, right, that we can analyze phenomena that are too small to see and that span the entire universe, right? So although I don't know if you could point to something, you know, scientifically that drives in this direction, but the end result of these laws of nature is the human brain, the most astonishing entity in the physical universe. So I think, you know, if we were talking about if you're winding the clock back to the dawn of time and God using a set of laws that would produce this, so it's an astonishing set of laws that has this result.
Thank you. Der Herr hier vorne.
Also. Sie haben sehr schön die Entwicklung des Homo sapiens geschildert und die Entwicklung unseres Gehirns. Und mich würde mal interessieren, die Frage gilt an beide, was Sie denn zu der Entwicklung Ihrer Religionen sagen. Also da blicken wir 3000 Jahre zurück oder 1500 Jahre zurück. Wie sehen Sie da die Notwendigkeit, dass das heute immer noch praktiziert werden muss?
Dankeschön.
Have you got any other questions?
I think, though, what we see is, in Islam, what we see is that Islam has, like, golden ages, and then it has low points. And then it has, we hope to have another golden age, because we all thrived under the golden age. The low points, not so much. So, but this is part of the human story, that there's no people who are always on top. You know, they have periods of moral and intellectual excellence, followed by, you know, the burning of mathematical documents because mathematics is from the devil, and, you know, and all kinds of foolishness like that. So we have had it in Islam, but if we're at a low point, we can also rise again, and in rising again, what that has been in the past is bringing the Christians and Jews among us to bring them up as well. So that kind of rising I'm in favor of. And if that's the lesson, I think, of human history and the lesson of our evolution of our religious beliefs, that, you know, it's cyclical. And it's that way, I believe, for many religions.
The question was really, you know, a broad question that takes us beyond the topic of this discussion. But to bring it back to the topic of tonight, it's interesting. If you look at the history of science, a lot of historians of science say that science originated with monotheism, because from the and other societies, there was no idea that there's any underlying, you know, patterns or regularities to nature. Science grew out of monotheism, because it was only once you had the monotheistic idea that there's one God who created everything, then it made sense to start to look for patterns, for the underlying laws of nature. You know, we speak about laws of nature, laws of science, but the concept of laws presupposes that there is an underlying order, a system. You know, who made these laws? Why do the laws have the form that they do? So many books in the history of science speak about science developing out of monotheism. And of course, while science has itself then presented many challenges, and religion has often had to, you know, accommodate science and struggle with science in various ways, but ultimately I believe that they can both enrich each other.
You know, I'll just have to disagree with you. I don't think that science evolved out of monotheism. I think that science existed with the first humans. That first human, you know, who said, I'm going to track this animal, and I'm going to hunt him down, and then I'm going to butcher him, and somebody be on the lookout so that we're not consumed by social carnivores. This is out on the plains of East Africa. I think that the first female that threw some seeds in the ground in the mud and then came back 2 weeks later and saw the sprouts, that was the beginning of agriculture. In fact, science to me is something that is a fundamental part of being a human, just like prayer is something that's a fundamental part of being a human. And now we've gotten to the point where we say, oh, we've characterized the deities that we worship and so forth. But I think that no, science is part of, it's not something for white men in white lab coats. It's something that's a part of being Homo sapiens. And we know that because we can look at the tool traditions that were made and the specificity in the tools, the lithic culture that suggests that people had an idea of exactly what they were making before it was a finished product. And so that gives me hope that we will never stop being scientists, that is observation, inquiry, quantification,
Those are the aspects of being scientific. It's just that we started writing things down. And unfortunately in the West, and I'm part of the West, but I can be critical of it. Unfortunately in the West, science has been an implement of white supremacy. So as a consequence, it's noted the value in white males and no one else. And so we've ignored the intellectual traditions of China, the intellectual traditions of India, the intellectual traditions of ancient Egypt, of Kemet, which is in Africa, and of the iron smelting of Bantu speaking peoples. We've ignored that, focused on our own excellence, and therefore developed a distorted picture of who can be a scientist. This has been very limiting. What I hope is that because of our faiths force us to open our minds to other people. Not all Jewish people are Ashkenazim, for example. Not all Muslims are brown, or certainly not all Muslims are Arabs. So we have to look at humanity in a different way. And when we do that, we start to see fundamental things that all humans do, which is one of them being science, which is also why we need to look broadly for the truths of many people in and outside of our faiths, so to chart a course for the future, because we don't know what the future will bring, you know, what new challenges will come. But we do know that there's always the prospect of extinction.
Ich habe drei Fragen. Ja. Ich habe vier Fragen, sehe ich hier. Ich würde jetzt vielleicht zusammenfassen, dass Sie die beiden Herren eben dran nehmen. Dann gucken wir mal, wie komplex die Fragen sind. Und dann habe ich noch den Herrn hier und hier. Und wer noch möchte, der muss sich entscheiden jetzt demnächst. Okay, haben Sie gesehen.
Ja, ich habe eine Frage an Rabbi Slifkin. Sie haben angedeutet, dass Gott die Evolution braucht und gebraucht. Aber andersrum braucht die Evolution auch Gott.
Okay. Und der Herr hinter Ihnen vielleicht noch? Ich nehme noch eine Frage dran. Und,
ist auch für den Rabbi Slifkin. Und von was Sie gesagt haben, ist der ganze Sinn der Evolution dann das menschliche Gehirn? Oder so, wir als Menschen, sind wir das Ziel der Evolution? Oder wie Frau Jackson meinte, gibt es auch einen danach, was sozusagen mit dem Menschen nichts zu tun hat, sozusagen. Und das war ungefähr die Frage.
Okay, we'll let you answer this and then take the other three.
Well, now, what I was speaking about is what is the, you know, the animal kingdom is extraordinary in many different ways, right? You look at the grace of a cheetah, right? The color-changing ability of a chameleon, right? All kinds of extraordinary phenomenon. What I was speaking about before was the idea, I feel that the human intelligence is also unique. But we're not just the most intelligent creature. You know, you have the fastest creature, the strongest creature. But I feel that intelligence is something very special. Intelligence is something that enables us to move beyond our planet, right? To contemplate questions about existence. I feel that intelligence is something that's extremely special and that carries with it responsibilities, moral obligations. And I feel, in that sense, I was speaking about evolution being an extraordinary system with this as, I think it fits with religion in the sense of seeing that, look at the end result, right? You have the human brain that's capable of intellectual and spiritual growth. And I feel that is the, I'm not saying that we won't evolve further, maybe we will evolve further, I was describing this as being an expression of the majesty of creation, of the crowning glory of creation, I would put it that way. Now the earlier question was about, does evolution need God? So I would say that it does, in the sense of the point I mentioned earlier, which is, of all the conceivable universes, right, most universes would not be as special as this one. Right? We live in a very, very special universe. It has scientific laws that produce matter, that produce planetary systems that allow for the emergence of life. So, you know, you could posit that there's maybe an infinite number of universes, and some people do, but we don't exactly have any evidence for that either. And even if you do posit an infinite number of universes, there still has to be some kind of meta-universe that governs all those. So I think, you know, the fact that we have an extraordinary universe with extraordinary laws of nature, I wouldn't say that it proves God, but I would say that it very it grounds belief in God in a rational basis.
Would you like to add something, Dr. Jackson?
Well, we say in Islam that that Allah created everything that's on this planet, and if there's life elsewhere, he's responsible for that too. So we now don't talk about the universe, we talk about the metaverses. There are many, 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 many hundreds of thousands of potentially life-bearing planets. This is what the astrophysicists tell us. And if they support life, that life also submits to the will of God. Then, you know, then I don't have to worry about it, you know, until we have a visit from outer space, until they reach the technological level or the curiosity level to come visit us, you know, it's not a problem because they too submit to the rule of God. There was something else about this. Does evolution need God? Evolution is going to proceed whether we recognize God or not. But I used to wonder, why does God exist? And the ulama said that God exists. When God was asked, why did he create all of this? And his answer was, so that I would be known. He wanted to be known. So maybe that's our responsibility, is to acknowledge his presence and his omnipotence. There's not much we can do about it. Things are going to change one way or another, you know, but to try to get in sync with what we understand to be his mandate, not to over-exalt our position, because we are replaceable. And I sometimes wonder, when will God get sick of us and replace us with another species, a better species, maybe one that will obey him better and not create so much turmoil and hatred and genocide and sexism and homophobia and other kinds of ridiculous behavior that decreases our viability, makes us less stable as a species. So that's just, again, does evolution need God? No, I can't say that because I don't have enough data to try evolution without a creator. God, he just is, you know? And maybe you have, as a theologian, better words, because we say that Islam and Judaism are like this in the laws. We're closest to you in the laws. We're closest to the Christians in the emotional. Emotion. But in the laws, we're closest to the Jews. So maybe you have a better definition, a better way of conceptualizing this, but God just is. And for me, if the Quran, if the Torah, if the Injil were all proven to be false, we still have God. That he exists outside of my domain of control. And so I did a cost-benefit analysis and said, okay, if I don't believe, what's the penalty? If I do believe, what's the reward? I'm going for the reward.
Ich würde das jetzt so machen. Also wir haben vier, ich habe sie alle gesehen, die sich bis jetzt noch gemeldet haben. Da hinten war ein Herr, der war als erstes dran. Der dürfte jetzt seine Frage stellen. Melden Sie sich einfach noch mal kurz das. Ja, genau.
Ich mache auf Deutsch. Meine Frage / Anmerkung geht oder knüpft an die Frage von dem Herrn da vorhin an. Und zwar bezüglich, ich hatte seine Frage eher so verstanden, dass Religion eine Funktion erfüllt hat in der Evolution oder das Abfeuern oder das Feuern verschiedener neuronaler Verbindungen dafür gesorgt hat, dass Menschen geglaubt haben und dass der Glauben, wie gesagt, eine Funktion hatte, um sich nicht den Naturmächten ausgeliefert zu fühlen oder Ähnlichem. Und genau meine Idee war dann, oder meine Frage wäre dann, es ist ja so, dass wenn Neuronen oder so abfeuern und dann kann man das empirisch nachweisen, dann versuchen wir den Daten eine Bedeutung aufzuerlegen und sagen dann, okay, man kann das hier und so sehen. Und versuchen wir nicht gerade dadurch, dass wir die Erkenntnisse oder die Theorie der Evolution interpretieren, auch noch Gott hineinzuinterpretieren, wenn doch Gott nicht gerade dieses Unerfassbare, Unerklärliche darstellt? Also ich weiß nicht, ob ich mich komplett klar ausdrücken konnte. Also meine Frage richtet sich eher danach, ob wir versuchen, zwanghaft Gott hineinzuinterpretieren in die Evolution.
Okay. Ich würde noch den Herrn hier vorne dran nehmen und dann mache ich die letzte Runde mit Ihnen und Ihnen dort drüben. Ja, aber
jetzt erstmal. I have another direction. My question is, what do you think about or believe in fiddling with the genes, pushing the evolution in a direction through biotechnology and what all we do now? You know, all the time we are seeing, we have now the Chinese have just manipulated a baby, and I think that's a very interesting.
Okay. I would give the. There are two more questions, but I think it's too much if we collect them now. So if you could answer that now and then.
Okay. With regard to the first question, I think you were asking that we can scientifically explain how belief evolved. Could be. It could be we could scientifically explain it, but that doesn't mean that there aren't very good reasons for it. All right. With regard to the second question about genetically engineering people, things like that, I would say that from a religious perspective, we should be cautious, we should be humble, but there's nothing in principle wrong with it. In fact, the idea of circumcision, you know, says that we don't need to leave the biological entities as God made them, that there is room for us to work on them. So I don't think there's anything in religion that precludes the idea of genetic manipulation.
Yeah, I agree with you. Genetic manipulation is going on all the time anyway. That's called domestication. So, you know, so we're doing it, now we're just doing it faster. So the problem with the Dr. Hu Liu, who did the Chinese researcher who was doing the CRISPR, using CRISPR-Cas technology to manipulate the gametes of these two human twins that were born. The problem was that they did it first. Okay, so yeah, you see, okay, so that's part of the problem. They did it first. And the other problem is that HIV/AIDS is not a big problem in China. But imagine if he had done that in Natal, in South Africa, where it is a big problem. Then that he could have, for it to be a public health importance, if he could manipulate the genomes of all of the babies born in Natal, we'd have a whole generation that would be resistant to HIV/AIDS, which would be great, you know? We have the capabilities now we're on the verge of being able to create actually new species. But what I want you to not be worried too much, because species is a term we made up. As scientists, we make it up. You know, we say that a horse and a mule are, and a horse and a donkey are two separate species, but then, or that a Neanderthal and a human are two separate species, but then when we find a hybrid like us, then we then we say, oh, well, species is a fuzzy concept. The biology doesn't have hard laws. It has principles, but not really hard laws like in physics, you know? So I'm thinking really about this question of, does God need evolution? And the answer is no. We need God. We need God. We're the ones who are benefiting from this relationship with God. I think God just wants to be known. But, you know, if he's not known by us, then he'll be known by other creatures. And he'll be known by angels. He'll be known by the jinn. He'll be known by life on other planets. So we're here to acknowledge the magnificence of God. And for me, it's through my science. You know, and I really appreciate that the rabbi is not only interested in the rabbinical law, which we also believe is part of God's word, but is also interested in the natural world. It's wonderful because it's through that natural world that that I found my God. And so I'm feeling that there's a connection here that we should emphasize and amplify for the betterment of our species. We need to give direction to people who are polarized, who think that science is the enemy of religion.
You had a question?
Yeah, I have a question. Professor Jackson, it's been a real honor to meet you. And for 20 years, I've been lecturing about the interface between science and Judaism. And in that time, I've met many people, talking about my co-religionists, many people who are very receptive to what I have to say, and many people who are very hostile to what I'm trying to say. And I would say overall, it's hard to give specific numbers, but assuming there's about a million religious Jews in the world, I would say it's split about 50-50 between the people who want to reconcile science and Judaism and the people who feel that science threatens them and are hostile to it. I'm just wondering what your experiences have been and if you could comment on what it's like in the Muslim community.
I wish we were 50-50.
No, I don't think so. It's still working. Oh, it's... No, I think...
It's this.
It, just give it to me and I will check if...
Okay. Yeah, I wish it was 50-50. I think it's more like 90-10 against. Because of the... because look, most people in the Jewish community are highly educated, especially in the United States. That's not the case for Muslims. Oh, thank you. I destroyed the other one. Getting so excited. I think for in the United States and throughout the world, look, the people who are in the Muslim communities, many are not that well educated. We have a very narrow pyramid at the top, you know, in terms of educated people. I actually think it's a hopeful sign that more Europeans are becoming Muslims because, especially Germans, because I'm going to resort to a stereotype here. Maybe we'll be on time for prayers now. You know, I have encountered hostilities, but I don't let that bother me because, first of all, I live in America. So all those people who hate me, you have to get through our security system to get me. The other thing is, really, you know, in the end, what I've seen, especially with the more reactionary communities, is that they implode because you just can't maintain such rigidity. Remember I mentioned prison Islam? That's where people go to prison. And prison is very, very structured. But if you try to have that structure outside of prison, outside of the prison environment, people can't live with that. And so most of those communities implode. They turn in on themselves. They're not sustainable. It is laudable that people want to follow the Salafi, example of the first two generations of Muslims. That's laudable. But we also have to temper that, you know, so that we're not saying, oh, you can't drive cars, you have to ride horses, or you can't shoot guns, you have to shoot bow and arrow. Come on. We have to gear our thinking for the 21st century if we intend to participate in it. And it seems to me that recognition of the wisdom of evolutionary thinking is part of gearing oneself to live in the 21st century. What do I mean? We cannot live like we did when we were in a Paleolithic era, when we were xenophobic, when we were afraid of anybody who looked different from us. We can now create machines that work faster than our own brains. So we need to be united as a species. Otherwise, we're going to lose our hegemony.
Gut. Die letzten zwei Fragen. Einmal der Herr hier vorne hat sich eben gemeldet. Das Mikrofon kommt gleich zu Ihnen. Und Sie habe ich auch noch auf dem Schirm natürlich. Das Mikrofon kommt dann danach zu Ihnen.
Ja, vielen Dank. Ich habe eine allgemeine Frage, und zwar, Sie haben ja jetzt einen langen Zeitraum der Evolution beschrieben, und zwar sehr eindrücklich und sehr interessant. Wir sind ja jetzt als Krönung der Schöpfung die Menschen entstanden durch diesen langen Prozess. Homo sapiens, sagten Sie. Ich habe die Befürchtung, dass wir allerdings auch vor einem evolutionären Kollaps stehen. Habe ich den Eindruck, auch nach dem, was Sie geschildert haben. Die derzeitige Situation der Menschheit sieht ja so aus, dass sie geprägt ist durch Umweltkatastrophen, durch Genmanipulation, durch Biotechnik, durch Klimaveränderungen und so weiter, durch künstliche Intelligenz. Ich weiß gar nicht, oder zum Beispiel soziale Medien, die uns verdummen und alle möglichen Phänomene, die dazu führen, dass wir Menschen irgendwo an einer Grenze stehen. Und ich weiß nicht, ob den meisten das bekannt ist. Ich weiß auch nicht, ob die Religion dem etwas entgegensetzt, denn ich denke, dass Fundamentalismus oder schlimme religiöse Auffassungen um sich greifen und dass so aufklärerische Ansichten, wie Sie sie vertreten, nämlich die Vereinbarung von oder Vereinbarkeit von Evolution zum Beispiel und Religion, dass das auf dem Rückzug ist. Und was können wir diesem Kollaps, den ich durchaus sehe durch diese Menschheitsveränderung zur Zeit, die wir auf der Welt erleben, was können wir dem als solche aufgeklärte religiös-Gläubige entgegensetzen? Das ist meine Frage.
Okay. Vielen Dank. Jetzt würde ich noch den Herrn hier vorne dran nehmen und...
Ja, meine Frage geht an Rabbi Slifkin. Wenn die Evolution davon ausgeht, dass Affe und Mensch gemeinsame Vorfahren haben, wenn die Religion davon ausgeht, dass der Mensch als eine lebendige Seele, also mit einer Neshama, geschaffen wurde, dann würde mich interessieren, wann kam denn diese Neshama in den Affen oder Frühmenschen, vielleicht eine Sekunde, nachdem er Feuer gemacht hat?
Vielen Dank.
Okay, so in response to the first question, is this working?
It's working.
Yeah, is it? Okay. In response to the first question, as a great man once said, with great power comes great responsibility. Anyone know who said that? Spider-Man's Uncle Ben. Yeah. Yes, mankind has great power, and that does bring it great responsibility, right? We have the potential to destroy our world, and we have the responsibility to advance beyond anything that any species has ever done. In fact, there's a midrash, an ancient rabbinic teaching, which says that when God created man, it says, he says, God said to man, look at this beautiful world that I've created. Take care that you don't destroy it. In other words, man has the power to destroy the world, and man has the power to produce things that no animal can ever create. So yes, it can go both ways. With regard to the other question about when the soul enters the body, so I wasn't there, so I can't tell you exactly. There have been those who have proposed that the creation of man in the Bible means the unique event, God inserting a soul into a particular hominid. But there are others, such as Rabbi Soloveitchik, who wrote a very important book called The Emergence of Ethical Man, where he describes it not as the soul being, a spiritual substance that at one point in time was suddenly appeared, but rather the soul means the gradual development of consciousness, of the awareness of morality. And so like Professor Jackson said, that where you have the spectrum from blue to red, there's no one particular point where there's a transition. So too, there was a gradual development. The creation of the soul means the gradual development of the human capacity for self-awareness and for making moral choices between good and evil.
Okay, Professor Jackson.
Just to, I agree with everything you said, but I would just, and I would add that, I lost my thought. I'm sorry. I'll come back to it.
Yeah. I think I will finalize our conversation.
And I came back. I got it. It was floating around, and I snatched it back. And it was this. It was in response to what do we do? So forums like this are very positive. I wish we had forums like this in the United States, but we're a little behind, you know? We have great power, but we're like a teenager with a weapon. We don't know if we're gonna shoot the ceiling, shoot you, shoot myself, shoot the floor, you know, we're not sure. So things are more precarious within the American context. But that's all part of our test, part of our challenge. And it's a challenge I believe that the Creator has given us. What kind of people are we going to be? And I see the bonds of unity being way stronger than the small divisions, you know? Divisions like how we pray, what we call our Creator. That's not what's important, because whatever we're calling him, he probably got other names too. The other beings on other planets are calling him other names also. That's what's more important is what kind of person does it make us? And can we unite on the superiority of that kind of person? It may mean that we did some things better in the past than we're doing right now, because human history is not linear. You know, it fluctuates, it oscillates. So I think we need to have more forums bringing together the great monotheistic religions as a start. And believe me, I think other religious groups will join, like Hindus and Taoists and others and Buddhists. Because if we're on the right track, a track that promotes survival for the species and survival for the planet, and if we emphasize that, then we have a counter to the reactionary and actually self-destructive, quasi-fundamentalists, because they're not really fundamentalists. Stop calling them fundamentalists, because if they were fundamentally Jewish, they wouldn't be hurting people. If they were fundamentally Muslims, they wouldn't be hurting people. If they were fundamentally Christians, they wouldn't be hurting people. So, you know, those reactionary people who cover themselves with the blanket of religion but are doing evil deeds, we need to pull off the blanket, expose them, and present a version of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam that is in keeping with where we need to be in the 21st century and the 22nd century and the 23rd century, although I won't live to see that. You know? I really think that it behooves us as individual believers to actualize the true elements of our faith, not the superficial. I mean, tell me about superficial conflicts between Shia and Sunni Muslims over how they hold their hands in prayer. Come on, you know? So how do we find the important ties that bind and tighten those links so that we are united against our common enemy? Our common enemy, where is Sophia? I say our common enemy is Shaitan. Our common enemy is the devil, who said he would lay in the pathway and undermine the human existence. And that's what I see happening. So how do we push our agenda? By learning about each other's religion, religious beliefs, finding points of commonality, building on that, educating our children so that they have more open minds and more receptive minds. The nicest scene that I ever saw in a movie was when in the Mahatma Gandhi movie, where he had Muslims and Christians and Hindus all praying their own way, but praying together for the salvation of India. This kind of gives me goosebumps, because I want to see our species survive, you know, and I want to see us live together in peace, because I think that that's the challenge for a polytypic species like us. How can't we all just get along?
Yeah, perfect last words. Thank you. Yes. und mein Thanks oder mein Dank geht auch an Sie aus, die hier so lebendig mitdiskutiert haben und mit viel Geduld diesen Abend begleitet haben. Ich freue mich schon aufs nächste Mal und würde jetzt mich von Ihnen verabschieden, beziehungsweise auch von Ihnen verabschieden. Vielen Dank.